First, I would like to say how grateful I am for the opportunity to make music and records with Rick Danko, Garth Hudson, Lee Von Helm, and Richard Manuel. I'm convinced now, as I was then, that nobody in the world could sing and play the songs that I wrote with as much believability and soulfulness as they have.
Is this a documentary? So what is it then? I'm not gonna have to talk about things I've been trying to forget, am I? You know, Indians don't even believe in this kind of thing. In the summer, we would go to visit my relatives on the reservation. We would go out and play like the same kind of things that I would do in the city, but these guys didn't climb trees, they could run up a tree. And I was like, take a look at that. How in the world do you do that? And so, and I was trying to keep up with them all the time. They would run and like jump over something or run up a tree. And I'd get to the bottom of the tree and I'd think, how do you get down? How do you get up? We would be out playing and I'd say, well, could we like go swimming this afternoon? And they'd say, well, we don't want to go swimming this afternoon because it's gonna rain. And I'd say, well, how do you know? It doesn't look like it's gonna, how do you know it's gonna rain? And they would be like, you know, just smelling the air and they could tell that there was rain coming. Some uncles and cousins of mine who were from the Six Nation Indian Reservation, they were relatives of my mother's, they all played instruments. I don't know why, but it just seemed like every one of them knew how to play a guitar, a fiddle, a mandolin, sing, dance, do something, right? And it was the first time that I saw somebody playing music, like right there, right in front of me, and to hear their fingers moving on the strings and everything, oh, it just got under my skin. So I thought, oh, I got to get a piece of this. So I'd wait till after they had a couple of beers or something and hit on them to teach me something. Because before that, they were like, yeah, we'll get to you later, you know, because they just wanted to just pick and sing, you know, and have some fun. They didn't want to give lessons. And I remember this lick that I'd heard. It was the simplest thing, but it had an emotion to it that I could never get over. And it was a guitar player that played with Howlin' Wolf, and he did this. And that's all it was. He just did this. And when you hit the strings at the same time, when you went like, it just did a thing. It just gave me shivers a little bit. And I worked and I worked and to be able to go. I remember when I got off the bus and I smelt the air and looked around and the way people talked, it was in rhythm. You'd go down to the river. I mean, sitting on the edge of the Mississippi River, you know, was just too poetic in itself, you know. But the river going by and the riverboats, everything seemed to move in rhythm. And you could hear music coming from somewhere at night, always. It would be like just leaking out of somewhere, or the wind would change, and all of a sudden you'd hear a little harmonica in the distance, and you'd think, wow, you'd never hear anything like this up north.
High in the bayou.
To this day, when you're just rolling around the streets here late at night and you're hearing music, you can hear like some trumpet player, you know, playing out of some building and that, and you walk a little further and you'll hear another kind of Professor Longhair kind of music. And all this, it's all very exciting. It works with the humidity of the place, all of the elements that go together in this thing. It's a little of this and a little of that. And you put in these different elements and you mix it up and you make a new gumbo. And that gumbo is what they called rock and roll.
In Canada here, although there's a lot of great music up here, there's not a great tradition of the beat and the bottom. That comes from somewhere else, mostly from the South, I think. And I want it to be in a place where it had actually occurred, rather than, you know, just knowing about it through records. So that was really my main reason for going there, just to learn about rhythm. And I'm sure it was Robbie's pull to that same territory.
When I heard bottleneck guitar, I first heard Muddy Waters or Elmar James, I didn't know about that device. I didn't know that they were playing, you know, with a what you call a bottleneck. They would take a bottle and they would cut the neck off of it, and then they would sand it down, and you would put it over your finger, and you would play it like a slide. And I'd never seen that or heard of it, so I just thought it was somebody playing guitar in a very particular way. And I worked so hard trying to get that sound down. I mean, for months, I worked on it like day and night, you know, and I still, you know, there was like, it's just because it's a bottle and they can go like that, you get this very... It's very wide vibrato. Everything's like... You know, it's just because they're doing that with a bottle. And then when I found out that it was this thing that they put on their finger, you know, I was like, oh, Jesus, you know, my fingers are bleeding and I've been like working on this thing.
Oh, what a man did, but a fool he can, but when you can go for these 7 nights, and what's it done in the dark, is that to come to the light? A good advice, you keep on going when you show you're right. You know, the blues are the roots, and other musics are the fruits.
So there was Helena, Clarksdale, and Memphis, all in this triangle right there. And out of this little area right there, at that time, came Bo Diddley, Muddy Waters, Elvis Presley, all those people, Jerry Lee Lewis, all those people on Sun Records. The amount of people, Jimmy Reed, just that came out of this one small area, thought, now, wait a minute here. There's all of this country around here. How come it all comes out of this small area? Well, it's called the Mississippi Delta. And that's the only excuse for it, is it has such a nice name. The lyric just felt so good that it rolled off your tongue. It didn't necessarily mean something, or maybe it did mean something, and who cares? It just feels so good to say, like the beginning of Tutti Frutti. Little Richard was from Georgia. He came here and got that song, and it was very clear, and all these early rock and roll songs that came out of here, that the feel was the most important thing. If it felt good, if it sounded good, it worked. When I first saw these guys play Ronnie Hawkins and the Hawks, it was the most violent, exciting thing musically that I'd ever seen. Ronnie Hawkins was like this kind of half man, half beast. I was playing with a little band and we played as an opening act for Ronnie Hawkins and the Hawks. And I was like, oh my God. This is the thing. This is where I've got to, in his words, swindle my way in on this. So I got to know them, and I would hang around, and I would try to be just the nicest guy that they'd ever met.
You know, he was a sharp young punk, you know, for his age, but he had that hubcap stealer look.
And then Ronnie Hawkins was getting ready to do another record, and I heard him saying, geez, I need to find some songs for this record. And I just went, bing, and I just went off and wrote some songs. This is when I was 15, and I came back, and I said, I have a couple of songs that I wrote. And they were like, yeah, the guy who gets the coffee now is writing the songs, right?
I know, unless I've gone completely mad, that I recorded those songs as, hey, Bobaloo was a name. She don't love me, but I loved her just the same. Treat me mean, treat me cruel. Treat me just like I was a fool. I was a fool. Hey, Bobaloo. Then he'd hit them licks. And, boy, I thought, we got a kid here that, man, by the time he's 21, he may be Irving Berlin.
And it was just, it was overwhelming to me that this thing actually worked. They weren't very good. I can, now that I got the gig and everything worked out, I can admit they weren't too hot. So he thought I might be able to hear songs. So he took me to New York to the Brill Building.
I was pushing Robbie's writing. I said, this kid's got a little knack. He had these little songs when he was so young. And I said, well, here's the catch you're going to meet one of these days.
This is Lieber and Stoller. This is Palmas and Schumann. This is Otis Blackwell. He wrote Don't Be Cruel. And these guys wrote hundreds of hits, these guys. They just poured them out every day. And he said, I'd like you to listen to their stuff. I've got things to do here and everything. And see if there's anything you think would be good for me to record. That would, you know. So I was 15 years old. They're playing songs, and I'm saying, geez, that was good. You got anything else? I probably practiced 12 hours a day at that time. Never even thought about, wow, this is intense. I couldn't stop. I would just, you know, I would just do it until, you know, it was time to go to sleep, and I would get up and I would start again. And I had a thing, Ronnie Hawkins, you know, it was a competitive thing. It wasn't like, okay, you're just automatically the guy. It was like, if you can cut this thing, you know, you'll get the job.
I give everybody 90 days, and in 90 days, I can tell if they're going to be able to fit in with what we want or not.
And so I just was a boy on a mission.
Boy, he started getting those licks down, and you learn licks first, and you put a lot of licks in, then it takes you another year or two to know where to put those licks.
And I just came to the conclusion that nobody's going to try, nobody's going to be capable of trying harder than me, so I'll win.
And when we'd take off to have a little party or whatever it was, Robbie would stay and practice. You'd hear that guitar, that old cheap-ass Telecaster whining all day and all night long. And finally his fingers, the calluses had calluses on them, you know?
We started, you know, with other bands that would be opening acts for Ronnie, just like I was one of those. We would see some of these bands, and there was some, and each of them there would be like one really talented guy. And we started just lifting these guys out of all these bands. And those guys that we took were Garth Hudson, Richard Manuel, and Rick Danko.
I always compare rock and roll, early rock and roll, to boxers, fighters. You can hit the heavy bag forever, but the heavy bag doesn't hit back. You gotta get in the ring, and that's when you learn. And so that's what we'd do. We'd practice till we'd get all the kinks out of the songs and all that, and get the arrangements, and practice day, you know, all night long. But you have to get in front of a crowd to get, you know, get your energy up. And that playing 7 days a week got them ready.
You had to have a Cadillac. If you didn't have a Cadillac, you weren't on the road. So you'd have a Cadillac and a trailer behind it. And on these trailers, you know, people would paint like little emblems to symbolize who their groups were. And playing with Ronnie Hawkins, there was a hawk on the back, and you'd be driving down the road and you'd see some other band go by on the other going the other way, and you'd wave at them, and it was all quite charming. And then after a few like jackknifes on, with the trailer on the road, and you're spinning around. And but you always seemed to get out of these things. It didn't seem like that there was any real danger in it. But later on, you started to think, ooh, geez, I don't know, that was a kind of a close call, too.
We wanted to be just such a good band. And now we had the ingredients that we could all kind of feed off one another and just raise the level of our musical abilities. Garth Hudson had a lot to do with this because he was a musician who could play, he could have played with us or he could have played with Miles Davis or the Symphony Orchestra.
I couldn't let him play the stuff that they really wanted to play that could really go over for musicians because we're playing in bars. And when you play in bars, you've got to play what the music want or you out of a job.
We started to outgrow it a little bit. And with that, other conflicts came.
I guess it was 64. I can't remember time, boys, but 64, 65, somewhere in there, everybody was trying to harm. I mean, every big act that came through was trying to hire this band because they were that good.
And there was other things, and it all kind of mounted up. And finally, it was the time to tell Ronnie that we were going to move on.
And so when they left, it was still Levon was in charge. They went out and recorded under Levon and the Hawks, I think, and the Crackers. They had three or four different names.
It was a tough time for us, you know, just leaving and going out, you know, not knowing where we were going, where we were going to play, you know, who was going to book us or anything. You were always looking for clubs, places that you could play that didn't just work you to death.
I remember being in a hotel in the middle of the night and this guy, one of the guys in, I was playing with, he said, geez, I'm dying to get some milk. Would you walk with me over to the store to get some milk? So I said, yeah, sure. What's the big deal? Get some milk. And so we went to the hotel and it wasn't very far. We walked across the street and we went and got the milk, and as we were coming into the store, we could hear these, some shooting, some gunshots. And we walked out and, you know, we were just curious of what was going on. Walked out and this guy came running by and he bumped into my friend and he knocked this quart of milk, which was glass, out of his hand, and it like splashed all over the sidewalk. And these people are shooting. And he's saying, Jesus, look at my milk.
But Robbie was, you know, he wasn't a show-off like the rest of us. He was Mr. Cool. Always was, even as a kid. You know, he didn't get in the battles much either, you know. We'd get out there and fighting for our lives. Robbie'd be wiping them strings off. He didn't like violence too much. He'd clean up his guitar while we're out there, goddamn losing teeth. And
and we didn't even, we weren't aware that these people were actually, you know, trying to kill one another, and all we were concerned about was that we had no more money left for any more milk.
And when she comes my way, I'll just be there spending night and day.
We got a call from New York City. There was this folk singer, Bob Dylan, who was decided that he wanted to get a band and play electric music. Electric? We never even heard this term. Electric? What does that mean, electric music? We never had an acoustic moment, you know, in our lives. You know, it was electric music. Ooh. Okay, but I guess from a folk angle, that's what it was.
By that time, Robbie looked like he was kind of taking care of the business. I don't know how that switch came over, you know, but Levon never did like to do business anyway.
So I went to New York and I met with him and...
Thank you.
was so foreign, the idea of adapting folk music to electric music. And these kind of songs where the words were coming at you like a mile a minute. This was no longer oop boopy doo. You know, this whole idea, this music from here, that you just say anything and it's all cool. This was very precise, smart kind of music. We thought, what do we do? We play, and this guy's like going on about something. He's talking about this and the wars, and my God, it was like, what is this? It was so funny that, because we weren't hiding, you know, the way we felt about this at all at the time. And he didn't seem to care. He thought there was some kind of, you mix this, mix that, there was some kind of, I don't know, real thing that was happening. And while we're trying to say to ourselves, is this music? Is this working? What we're doing, it's fun and it's exciting when we're doing it. But it's like, I've never heard it before, so I don't know if it's valid or not. Things happen that way, you know, when you have nothing to compare something to, that's good news. But while you're doing it, you don't know that. All you know is this could be completely ridiculous, completely wrong. We're breaking all the rules. And on top of that, when we went and played, every night we'd go somewhere, set up our equipment, play for the audience. They would boo us the whole show. We'd pack up, we'd go on to the next town, they would boo us, and we did that all over the world. People attacked the stage, you know, and threw stuff at us, and it was eggs, and, you know.
When Levon was really depressed, he said, man, we're getting booed with this. And I said, yeah, but Levon, look, remember that old gal that used to come in and chew my ass out every night? She said, Ronnie Hawkins, you're the worst singer in the goddamn world. And she said, I've seen you four times this week, and you don't get any better. I said, baby, as long as you come in four times, I love you. As long as they're buying tickets, you know, let them boo.
Then we came back to New York City. It was an extraordinary period right then. I was living at the Chelsea Hotel.
The lobby would be filled with people that didn't live in the hotel. They were just there waiting for somebody, and they didn't know who they were waiting for. They were just there in case somebody of interest that they wanted to meet would be there, and they would just hang around the lobby and look at these kind of atrocious pieces of art on the wall. I remember there was this one thing that everybody would look at when they came. It was a big picture, and it was made up, it was just a bunch of combs. And it didn't matter who they were, for some reason this attracted everybody, and they would come into the lobby, they'd look around the place, and finally they would mosey over to this thing, and they would stand there with this very serious looking, this picture with just hundreds of combs in it, kind of nodding like, I understand this.
Levon had left for a while. He had left because he didn't quite buy this whole folk rock shit, right?
I remember them calling me and saying, they're going with Bob Dylan. I said, you boys made a mistake. This guy ain't gonna go too far, man. He sings worse than I do.
Now it's Bob Dylan in the band, and we go up, we play, and we hardly do a note different than what we originally did, and people are saying, this is the business. It felt like, you know, when things change and things move around, that the world kind of rotated in that direction, and we didn't change a lick. The world changes. So it was kind of a sweet thing, you know, in some way, you know, to have gone through such hell and come out the other end, and at the other end someone said, yeah, it was right.
These were uncontrollable times, and God knows what we were thinking about. And I don't know how so many crazy ideas seemed to make so much logic at the time. It was part of the times. It wasn't that anybody was really on any kind of a mission to destroy themselves. But it is a wonder that we survived.
They were living, you know, a little fast for the times. They were having a lot of fun. And then when Dylan got sick or had a motorcycle wreck or something happened, That's when Albert, I guess, gave them the chance to go in and record their own stuff.
And Albert Grossman had always said to us, you guys should come up there. There's hundreds, thousands of places you can get together and, you know, turn them into whatever you want, your clubhouse. Because I always talked about the clubhouse effect of having a place like the Bowery Boys, where you could get together every day, you go down there and you talk about what's going on, you know, what kind of trouble you're gonna get into. So it was like a street gang approach, but instead of fighting, you played music. And we eventually, one by one, moved up to Woodstock. We got this house in West Saugerties, which everybody, just because it was so ugly, people named it Big Pink. It was this, you know, but it was in the middle of, you know, like around it, it had 100 acres. There was nobody to bother, you know, it was like, the freedom was overwhelming. So that was the clubhouse. We would go there every day and do whatever, talk, play checkers, a lot of checker playing going on then. After we moved at the Woodstock, we said, oh, this is gonna work great. It's time to call Levon and say, now we're gonna get down to business. And then eventually Garth set up in the basement, you know, a little tape recorder and a couple of microphones that were left over from the tour or something. And the next thing, we made the basement tapes there with a freedom unknown to man in making music. Because we had thought while we were doing the basement tapes, nobody will ever hear this, so it doesn't matter what we do. You're there for a while and you get to know the guy at the grocery store and the post office. And you go, hey, Slim, you know, good to see you. Go over to the bakery and the woman over there, she's always nervous about something, you know, and she's bringing out the pastries and it just all becomes this thing. Oh, you get it all down and finally people, that's how we got the name of the band, actually. People just say, oh, he's one of the guys in the band, you know. There's
the win and she bet on another to show. She sends me in my spring of deep that she meant me. I don't have to speak. She defends me a drunkard's dream if I ever did see one. I picked up all of my winnings and I gave my little best.
Bob used to write all of his songs in a typewriter. I don't know whether anybody ever knew that, but you know, you picture people sitting down to write a song and they have their instrument and they have their music stand and their thing and everything. He wrote all those songs on a typewriter. Just ding, ding, you know, he was just writing away and it's like, here's another one, let me see. Oh, I got it. Put another piece of paper, ding. So when this music did come out, the basement tapes and music from Big Pink and Bob Whitten made John Wesley Harding, it was like it had this whole mystery. Ooh, they're up there in the mountains. God knows what they're doing now. It must be weird. They're probably, you know, doing freaky things up there for all we know, like Quakers on acid. And I had our first daughter, and this was going on. I was trying to write the songs for this record, we were, you know, all together, we were put ourselves in the spot like, okay, you guys did something, now you really better do something amazing. And I was trying to write Get Up with the Baby. I mean, it was one of these things that it just used me up while we were making. And then our schedule was, well, we're going to make the record, and then directly after that, we'll go up to San Francisco and play at Winterland, our first debut concert, right? And by the time I was done with the record, you know, I was very, very drained and exhausted. And we got to San Francisco, I was already like in bed with this fever and everything, and everybody panicked. And then in a last minute desperation, Bill Graham and Albert Grossman said, why don't we get a hypnotist? Had him brought in, this man all in black, came in and he put his hand on my head and spoke French, right? I thought, well, you know, it's worth a shot, you know. I mean, at this point I don't have anything to lose, since we're supposed to go on in 4 hours, right? So we start to play, we're going along, and the crowd is, I'm looking down, and this crowd is a little psychedelic to me, because, you know, I'm just in this strange frame of mind, and the people are like, and I look over at him with this pathetic look, and he was standing over there like this, like Mandrake, you know, on the sidelines with these eyes beating out, and he would say, grow, and I can hear it like right directly in my ear, louder than the music, louder than anything. And I actually start to come back, and I'm feeling like pretty good. I think, boy, this is all right, you know? So then we finished, came off the stage, I went over and I said, Pierre, I said, this was an extraordinary experience, you know, I'll never forget this, I can tell you. And he says, well, you could use this in your life. Anytime you're not feeling too great, you just say to yourself, grow, and then, you know, this will have the same effect on you. I said, really, for the rest of my life? He said, yeah, that's the way it's gonna work. So anyway, he gave me like a little pinch on the cheek and said, I'll see you in the stars, and left. And I've never ever heard or seen from him again.
I pulled into Nazareth. I was feeling about half past dead.
One of the things I did in Woodstock was just like an assistant director where I would...
Isn't that funny that...
You know, I would talk to the cameraman through an earphone and say, so-and-so just ran out, try to pick up for him. That was, you know, they could hear me.
Yeah.
You know, what were you saying? I'm sorry.
No, it was like just, it was very funny to find out, you know, later on that you were actually at Woodstock. I didn't know that in the beginning.
Yeah.
That you were like this guy down there trying to get this thing on... You were on the stage, right?
I was on the stage, yes. 3 days and three nights. It was one of the worst experiences of my life when you guys came on the stage. Most uncooperative. It was impossible. We loved you. And then we got the word, we can't get on the stage. Can't get on the stage. How are we going to shoot them?
Yeah.
How are we going to shoot these guys? But we got the word that we could only stay on the lip of the stage, which there was a little platform that we were, the stage was, was here. We were here on this little lip here, this sort of thing. And we were like, from our heads up, you could see, we could see the stage, you know, this way. I tried cutting a couple of the songs together, but, you know, the footage wasn't as exciting because of that. So we were like, and we were very, very upset because we wanted to be up on the stage with you guys. But I remember when you came out, you gave a certain look to the audience, and it looked like it was basically, leave us alone.
The playing that we were doing, our music was taking place in a living room.
Yeah.
We would get just everybody would sit around the living room, like with guitars and mandolins and fiddles and stuff, and play mountain music. Or else we would play in the basement. And because we hadn't played anywhere, it was like, we're going to play our first show in front of 500,000 people.
I realize it was your first
Maybe
show.
We should work our way up a little bit.
Yeah, and when I said we were there on the stage 3 days and three nights, it was because we couldn't get anywhere else. We couldn't leave. It's funny because now I understand why your body language was like that. You were all kind of huddled together and looking out at the audience like, what
who
is
are
this?
These
Who
people?
Are they here? What are they doing here in the basement? You know?
Yeah.
It's like, 500,000?
Yeah.
How do we get out of here? You know? I didn't realize it was the first time you guys had played together. I mean, you know,
there's that fly
there's
again.
That fly.
Do you remember this?
That?
The same
fly
from the last waltz.
17 years ago from the same picture.
As time went on, I saw that people had a passion for the road, a certain kind of thing that they just didn't feel they were living their lives unless they were going somewhere. And later on, as we became a little bit more successful, we were traveling in airplanes and skidding down the runway sideways. And all of these things, they add up and you start to get like superstitious about it. You start to think, how many rolls of the dice do you get at this before you finally crap out? But I noticed that nobody else around me thinks this way. And at some point I remember, because it happens very gradually, so you don't really say, we're disintegrating. But there was this very gradual thing going on where it just keeps drifting and drifting. And but I remember at one point saying, this is too hard to do. This is too painful to do. And something that I used to be able to do, I used to be able to get everybody's enthusiasm and we'd be really excited about doing something. Now, I couldn't cut through the fog anymore. Because of my own frame of mind, too. I was not in great shape myself, but like I said, I was just a little bit more chicken than some of the other people, so I felt like, I know what's going on here, you know? It's, everybody's doing this, and we were all in this together. We were all causing the damage together. But I remember one day going to the studio. We had something that we were going to do, and nobody came. And I sat there, and I left at the end of the day, and I thought, well, I devoted 16 years of my life to this. Maybe that's all it's asking of me. I don't remember any conversations with any of the other guys in the band saying, well, I guess that's it. I guess we're not going to pursue this thing anymore. That we've put it, we've not only put the road behind us, we have put the band behind us. But there was something happening that your instincts told you, this is going somewhere else. We still had this relationship. And whenever you felt like, I'm going to reach out in this, I'm going to express my feelings once more in this, that I would very much, everybody can do their individual projects, but I would love for this still to be the core of something, that we have the clubhouse thing to go back to. And it just kept drifting and drifting. And
like my father before me, I will work the land. And like my brother before me, who took a rebel stand. He was just 18, proud and brave, but a Yankee made him in his grave. I swear by the blood below my feet.
I read in places, you know, where people have talked about, you know, your films, and they've talked about the music that I've written, that you use music so strongly in your films. It was always like you were perhaps a frustrated musician.
Yeah.
And in the songs that I would write, everybody would say, they're so cinematic. Perhaps he's a frustrated filmmaker.
You know, Robbie's always loved movies since he was a kid. He'd go to the movies by himself and, you know, spend all Saturday in the movies. And I think secretly he's always wanted to make films. And he's made a few, but I think when he hasn't got his hands on a camera, he makes films with his music.
I had to go over to Martin Scorsese's house to talk to him about something that we were doing in the work.
So while I was over there, we talked about our official business and what we were doing. And when it was over, you know, some of the people that were there, they kind of drifted away. And it was just Marty sitting there. And I said to him, my wife just threw me out. And I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. And he said, I do. You'll move in here. He said, my wife just left me 2 days ago. So I moved in into the house. And he said, well, we've got to get this place, you know, fixed up now for us. You know, we'll finally get it the way it should have been all along. And he gave me this room, which was kind of like a den type room, with all of his classic movie posters all over the wall, and turned it into a bedroom. And then he said, but we have to watch movies in here. And then I came home the next day and I heard this hammering and pounding like somebody was building something, and they were building a projection room on the other end of my bedroom, right? And a little window, right, for the thing. I was working on the record, and sometimes I'd have to finish something up. I'd be like, and I'd come home, maybe I wouldn't get there till 1 or 1:30. And he'd be like pacing. I'd walk in and he was like, food's getting cold, we got movies here. I mean, I don't know what's going on. I was like, Marty, I'm just trying to finish up the music for this thing. Sometimes, you know, there was like the machine broke. I was making excuses, like, sorry, honey. You know, I would have been here on time. I know dinner's getting cold and you went to a lot of trouble and everything. But I needed to, like, just, you know. So he said, okay, fine. Well, we'll just eat quickly and then we can get the he was very anxious to get the film started, right? And when it was over, this horrible thing called daylight and birds. The birds, he'd say, the birds. Do you hear the birds? You know, and it was like, oh God, it made us sick, because what we had to do next was creeping up on us too quickly. And it was such a horrible feeling that we thought, something has to be done about this. And what he did was, a couple of days later, I came back up to the house and he had all the windows blacked out. And then he had this central air system brought in, so no windows would have to be open, so we never had to listen to those birds again.
I still work out when I do shot lists, or when I'm thinking about a movie, I listen to certain pieces of music and that's where I get the shots, or the treatment of the scene, visually, you know.
That's a very mysterious thing, where someone makes a choice that this works for this.
Yeah.
It's endless, the number of choices that could be made, and you put this and this together,
yeah,
and it's something happens. You put them together and they explode.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the greatest examples, I think, you know, in all of filmmaking music thing is the Mascagni. Music in Raging Bull. That music just became, you know, the passion, you know, his inner passion in the film. And do you remember this experiment that we did? There was one point in the film where Jake is walking down through the crowd and you wanted the music to play, but it was fighting
the damn sound effects.
And everything that was going on, and you're saying, well, there's got to be a way to make this work. Try this experiment where we took the music and fed it into a chamber and only used the return of the chamber. So you never heard the direct signal, and it made it sound like the music went inside. It was only, it was all happening inside.
It's like a Steadicam shot going into
And right up into the ring and everything. Ooh, it's very, very powerful.
I really don't see any difference between the music and the image. There just is none. There really isn't.
A long time ago, look, A long time ago, I was asked to do music for films, and I thought, this is an absurd idea. I want nothing to do with it.
Yeah, yeah.
Ever. That's why I've never done music for anybody else but you, because I thought, geez, if these people get me in a room and all of a sudden I'm going to stand up and say, you know what? I hate doing music for movies. You know, why am I here?
Get yourself under control. Oh, and let the good times roll.
It's the.
I just have to hear it.
Ain't no matter whether rainy weather. You want to have a ball? You gotta get yourself together.
We always said, going back to when we got like the temp things, that somehow the incomplete aspects of some of that, so in other words, where you're like humming and the fact that there's an unfinished quality to some of those elements work to the movie. It almost like spoke to the character, like the character
is very unfinished.
he's like grasping, you know, and this is going on. You know, and it worked at a couple times that we did it, and it works well.
Yeah, this is this is another kind of film music, you know, humming along with the score. This is man humming through the whole movie.
There.
Come in.
Hey, Sean.
Geez, I'm feeling much better. In this scene, Jack has to throw me into a headlock. It's the struggle scene, they call it. And in shooting this, it's been several days of headlocks. That's the never-ending headlock. And when you do it, 20, 30, 40 times, the accumulation catches up with you.
So I'm trying to get him calmed down, but he's
violent way, as we say.
In a violent way?
A bit.
I see, okay.
So just keep it loose.
Maybe you could explain to him that there was something very special that I got him for Christmas. I haven't given it to him yet, but pretty soon I'm going to be giving it to him.
Look, the main thing is the result. It's going great. If, you know, a few months of therapy or whatever. So we got it.
I'll keep her around. Yeah.
All right?
Okay, thanks very much.
Well, as you know, Robbie's a very emotional guitar player. And I love that about his playing. He doesn't play all the time, though. You know, he kind of pretends that there's other stuff that's more important, you know, like concepts and movie ideas. I think the rest of the world wants him to be a guitar player, as along with everything else that he wants to be. And if I was to do another record with him, I think that I would insist that he have that guitar in his hands all the time, you know. I think somebody as resourceful as Robbie works well with limitations. You know, if somebody plays a certain way, then he'll cater to that playing and organize the arrangement in such a way to maximize this person's talent. And he's a band leader, you know, like that's what he does. I mean, I guess he's a director of sorts, director of music. So if the people around him have obvious strengths, I think it's just in him to try and draw those strengths out and bring them up to the foreground.
And it's kind of like casting.
in a record, you know? Like, who is the right character? But in this case, it's just an audio thing. So it's just who has the right sound, the right character in their voice or the way they play.
I'm a man with clear destination. I'm a man with broad imagination. You fog the mind, you stir the soul.
I now feel a need to write some songs, and I'm kind of excited about it again. It didn't feel like, oh, geez, it's time to write songs again. What am I going to write about this time? I don't know if I'm in the mood. It wasn't like that. I was really feeling good about it. And so when I started writing the songs and figuring out how to do these songs, it had a direct link with the experience in doing the film music.
Well, Robbie's a great songwriter, as we all know, and I'm sure the archaeologists 50 years from now will look back and say, oh yeah, there was a great body of work.
You get inducted. It's such a harsh term. Okay, we're going to New York to be inducted. Well, it's the kind of thing that you can, in the beginning, feel very suspicious about, you know? And you think, oh Jesus, you know, this, what does that mean, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? But something happens at these ceremonies that doesn't exist anywhere else. It's like, can be very emotional and very funny, and it's not like these award shows. It's a whole other thing. But anyway, a lot of people go in with some reservations, and just about everybody comes out of this thinking, I saw some stuff tonight that I'll never see again as long as I live.
I want to talk about what it was like to be a musician, a serious musician who couldn't be in the band. And that was tough. It was hard. I remember being on tour in about 66 or 67 with a band called The Cream, and we thought we were the bee's knees, you know?
He got in touch with us, and he told me that he was breaking up his band, Cream. And it was because of hearing us that he decided to do that. And I thought, well, I kind of like Cream. I don't, well, what's the problem? And he said, well, it did something to him. And it was a decision that he had made.
I wanted to be in the band.
He was coming to Woodstock to ask to join the band. And he never mentioned it in all these years that was really what his plan was.
Only I didn't have the guts to say it, you know. I didn't have the nerve. I just sort of sat there and watched these guys work.
I mean, I could understand why he couldn't bring it up to me. I was the guitar player in the band. I mean, it was like, was he asking for my job, or was he just suggesting that we didn't have enough guitar players? I don't know.
I spent the rest of my career, until the last waltz anyway, trying to find ways to imitate what they had. And it was an impossible dream, really, because from where I came from and from where they came from, completely different worlds. But it was something to do with a principle that I got from what they did, which was integrity. Integrity and a standard of craft that really didn't bow down to any kind of commerciality. And I really identified with that, and I adored it.
After we performed that night, we realized that finally, I mean, he was talking about it there, but it finally happened. He did become, you know, part of the band.
Go down, Moses, there's nothing you can say. It's just old Luke, and Luke's waiting on the judgment day. Well, Luke, my friend, what about young Anna Lee? Said, won't you stay in the band or come back? Take a load off. Take a load off. Take a load off.
Clapton for being so gracious to induct us this evening. Most of all, I'd like to thank my wife, Dominique, who's been patiently putting up with me for 27 years. And our three children, Alexandra, Delphine, and Sebastian, for being the truest inspiration in my life. We should thank Ronnie Hawkins for being so instrumental in us coming together and for teaching us the code of the road, so to speak. Bob Dylan for not caving in when we were being booed everywhere we played and when just about everybody was saying, get rid of these guys. He didn't budge. And Elbert Grossman for his kitchen and his guidance and for actually starting the whole Woodstock thing. If it wasn't for Albert, the festival might have been called Poughkeepsie. The Poughkeepsie generation, it just doesn't quite have the same ring to it. I'd like to thank my friend Martin Scorsese for lending his filmmaking genius to The Last Waltz. I would like to say how grateful I am for the opportunity to make music and records with Rick Danko, Garth Hudson, Lee Von Helm, and Richard Manuel. I'm convinced now, as I was then, that nobody in the world could sing and play the songs that I wrote with as much believability and soulfulness as they have.
Corn in the field, I listen to the rise when the wind blows across the water. King harvest is surely come. I work for the union, 'cause she's so good.